إله إلا الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على خاتم النبي نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، respected listeners, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today is Wednesday, the 16th of August 2006. Once again, it is my pleasure to be with you. I hope yesterday I didn't give anybody a headache. I know we went through a lot of stuff and at a quicker pace. Remember, I said we are pressed for time. It's not my intention to speak so fast, but there's so much that we still have to say. And I said yesterday we are leaving so much already. So we have to quicken up the pace. I don't have much time left, and we have so much of the surah still to go. Now, I'm not going to answer any questions as I'm trying to utilize the time today to the best of our advantage in going through the surah. So please, can you write into me via email, as it was given to you out by the station, or it was given out to you by the station, sajidahmed.umar@gmail.com. sajidahmed, and then a dot, then umar@gmail.com. Those who don't have email access and wish to call in, you can do so at 082-229-0834. Now, just a quick recap of events yesterday. I spoke about patience, and we said that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam showed exquisitely that he possessed both categories of patience. As-sabr al-ikhtiyari wal-ittirari. Patience when you choose to be patient, like he chose to be when the king requested him to come out of the prison, he chose to be patient. And the other type of patience when you have to be patient and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests you and you exercise patience. And then we said that as-sabr ittirari, or when you have to exercise patience, that category is divided into two other categories, which are patience in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As-sabr fi ta'atillah. That you are patient when it comes to the performance of your salawat and all those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made compulsory upon you. Obviously, we have to exercise patience, as shaitan is a constant enemy and he's there always trying to turn us away from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being in in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to have patience in our worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we said the second category is as-sabr fi ma'siyatillah, that we are patient in that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram for us. We are patient in that we stay away from these things. Now, also we have shaitan there beautifying it for us, pushing us towards it, but we exercise patience and restraint and stay away from it. Why? Because we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared this haram for us and he has commanded us to stay away from it. And then we said that obviously istirari is patience that you exercise when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually tests you, when he places a condition over you, and Allah only tests because he loves you. إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ أَحَدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a person, he will test him. So you might lose a loved one, you might lose in a business investment, you might suffer a loss, somebody got injured, you might have hurt yourself. You know, the different tests, the different trials and tribulations that a believer finds himself going through, these are tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he exercised patience in that, and for him it is better, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are patient. So this is just a recap of what we said in regards to patience yesterday. I know I did go over it a bit quickly yesterday, so this is a recap for those who might have missed a few points. Then we spoke about an-nafs, the soul, and we said, or we read the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Inna an-nafsa la'ammaratun bis-su," that the soul is inclined towards evil, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Ammara." Ammara meaning, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the expressive form of the verb. So, meaning that your nafs is inclined to evil in a manner that is beyond comprehension. It loves all that which shaitan beautifies. And everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said is haram, it is inclined to it. Ammaratun bisu, except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon it. And then we said that some ulama have divided the soul into two categories. And some have divided it into three. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But we said that those who have divided it into two, they said that one is a nafs ammaratun bisu, your soul which is inclined to evil. And the second category is a nafs المطمئنة, the content soul. And then the ulama who divided it into three categories said, no, there's nafs ammaratun bisu, just as those in the first category said, then the soul which is inclined towards evil, and then an-nafs mutma'inna, the soul which is content. And then the third category is an-nafs al-lawwama, the self-reproaching soul. So they came up with three categories. So the reason why I am mentioning these different categories and the different sayings and interpretations of the ulama is for beneficial purposes. As I said, I am speaking on air. We are reaching out to a cosmopolitan audience, people from different walks of life. And I did mention that there are students of knowledge actually tuning in, and this is for benefit of them. And I did say after that for the normal person, what we need to understand is that part of our makeup is that we have a soul, a nafs. And this nafs is ammaratun bisu. It is inclined towards evil. Our job as a believer, as a worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to work against this nafs, is to teach this nafs, is to train this nafs, make it a nafsul lawama, reproach it continuously. Every time it is inclined to haram, you say no. If it wants to listen to music, you say no. If it wants to eat haram, you say no. If you want to dress in a manner that is disliked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you say no. So you are constantly reproaching this nafs, you are training it, and thus you convert it from a nafs, ammaratun bisu, a nafs which is enticed and inclined towards evil, to ya ayyatuha nafsul mutma'inna, to nafsul mutma'inna, which is the nafs that is content. The nafs that at the time of death Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls out to it in a manner that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from amongst those who at the time of death Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually calls out to us by saying, Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutma'inna. Now, before going on, just an important thought that came to my mind yesterday. And I was just remembering what my teachers were teaching me in regards to the aspect of al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira. The aspect of somebody drowning in the heat of a moment, or somebody letting the moment get the better of him. And the reason why this came to mind is when my lecturers were lecturing me in regards to Surah Yusuf, they were putting out or pulling out from the Surah so many aspects whereby Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam and Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam were passing the test of al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira, whereby you are faced with a situation and you are faced with a circumstance and situation and you come out on top. So what is the main reason for divorces nowadays, for a husband to divorce his wife? Al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira. He is in a condition or a situation where he lets the moment get the better of him. Obviously I'm talking about divorce in, you know, abnormal circumstances, not normal circumstances where really both parties have tried and at the end of it all, the only way out is divorce. I'm talking about premature divorces or immature divorces whereby it just happens all of a sudden and then both parties are in regret. What is the cause of this? Al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira. You let the moment get the better of you. And as a result, what happens? You act in a manner that you wouldn't act normally. And thus, afterwards, you regret your actions. So this is the main cause of divorce. Let us look at the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. When Yusuf alayhi salam was thrown into the well, he didn't fall into this aspect of letting the moment get the better of him. He was a young boy. He could have, or that could have happened to him. But he pulled himself together and he held himself together and he placed his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and was patient. He didn't fall prey to the aspect of al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira, whereby you let the moment get the better of you. That's one part. Then you have Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. After his children inform him that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is eaten by a wolf, at that moment it is very easy for somebody to drown in the heat of the moment. Meaning, you've heard this news, you're not even ready for it, it's the last thing you would expect, and then you hear this, it's like a big bang that happens to you. In that moment, you would forgive somebody for acting in a manner, in an abnormal manner, in a manner which is not praiseworthy. However, Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam conducts himself appropriately. He pulls himself together and he doesn't fall prey to the heat of the moment. Then we have the aspect of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam being sold as a slave. When he's sold as a slave, he still keeps himself together. He puts his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is sane. Most people who become insane is because they fall prey to al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira. They are faced with a circumstance and situation whereby they end up falling prey to the heat of the moment and they lose their minds. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam being sold as a slave beyond his wish holds himself together and passes through the test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam jailed oppressively. He is totally innocent and he's thrown into the jail. This is a moment which one can fall prey to, but he doesn't fall into the aspect of al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira. The reason why I'm saying it over and over again, maybe some of us will recognize it and memorize it, and I hope we understand this. That respected listeners, we need to make sure that we conduct ourselves appropriately. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test us. If we're having problems at home, we need to deal with them properly. We shouldn't deal with them in an abnormal manner. We shouldn't deal with them in a moment where the moment is hot, our minds are hot, we're not thinking properly, and then we carry out actions that we definitely will regret later. And the same way with parents, when it comes to their children, don't ever fall prey to this aspect of letting the moment get the better of you. Always be the bigger person. Stop and think, take a deep breath, sit down. If the situation doesn't allow that, walk out the home, go to the masjid, read two rakat salah, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his assistance, cool down, and then return back to the home and solve the problem in a normal manner. Whilst you are with your senses, thinking properly, making sure that after everything is complete, you don't regret your actions. So this is an important lesson. And as I said, the biggest problems we have today is because of this. The reasons of or the aspects of divorce, the reason why there are breakdown or there is breakdown in communication in the homes today, Muslim homes, and also in the different walks of life, in our businesses, brothers fighting with one another, Muslim brothers and real brothers, blood brothers. This is all from the ploys of Shaitan and a person's weakness in controlling his anger and a person's weakness in falling prey to al-istighraq fi lahzat al-hadira, falling prey to the heat of the moment, letting the moment get the better of him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So that is a brief recap of what happened yesterday and the little point that I wished to share with you. Now, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, as we know, is clear. The king asked the ladies confessed his innocence and confessed the guilt, and we've seen the main culprit was the wife of the minister. She actually spoke out and declared Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's innocence. Yesterday I ended on the aspect of or the ayah whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدَ الْخَائِنِينَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not guide the plan of those who betray. And I said this ayah reminds one of the ayah whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not support and make correct the work of those who cause problems, the work of those who are out to spoil. This is something which we need to understand. Sunnatullahi kawniyya fatma'in, meaning this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his creation. You need to be at peace. If you have somebody who acts with ulterior motives in life, tell him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not assist the way of those who do wrong, those who spoil. A student who cheats, as I said yesterday, we say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. A person who shows one quality on the outside, yet he possesses the opposite on the inside, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. A person who's unjust in their dealings, in their business dealings, or with their children, or with society at large, we say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. This is something we need to understand, respected elders, respected brothers, my dear mothers and sisters. We need to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not support the way of those who do wrong. Just in the case, or as in the case of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, they did wrong to him, but at the end, who came out on top and who remained at the bottom? And later on, we'll see, when the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam actually enter Egypt, who is above them, who is in a position of honor and status, and where or what is the condition of them so many years down the line after they did all that wrong. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُسْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. If in our homes we have somebody who is unreasonable, they are out there to cause problems, and today this is, you know, we hear these complaints in the home, maybe it's a new daughter-in-law who's entered the home and we have a difficult mother-in-law, or maybe it's a good mother-in-law and it's a difficult daughter-in-law, and we have circumstances and situations affecting the equal balance of the home. You know, affecting the equilibrium of the home, the normal balance of a home. we need to understand إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُصْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Instead of blowing something out of proportion, be patient, deal with it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not assist it. Why? Because Allah's way is not to assist those who do wrong. So this is a lesson also which I thought is important I share with you, an important ayah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُصْلِحُ عَمَلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his creation. Memorize it, learn it, understand it, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect one and all from being from amongst the group or those who actually go out in the land and spoil and cause mischief. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his protection. So the king said to the wine porter that, bring Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam to me. And after everything got cleared out, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam came. And then the king, after speaking to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, فَلَمَّا كَلَّمَهُ قَالَ إِنَّكَ الْيَوْمَ لَدَيْنَا مَكِينٌ عَمِينٌ. After speaking to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, indeed you are today established in a position whereby you are trusted. Subhanallah. So the king obviously recognized good in Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and we did say that he solved the problem. The best in the land couldn't solve the problem, and Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam did. So even more reason for him to be invited and for him to be placed amongst the group of those who are advisors to the king. So the king told him that, listen, from today you are or you have a trustworthy position, or I am in regards to you a person who trusts you, so you got nothing to worry about from today. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam speaks out to the king and he says, قَالَ جَعَلْنِي عَلَى خَزَائِنِ الْأَرْضِ إِنِّي حَفِيظٌ عَلِيمٌ. We learn here, well, before actually mentioning what we learn from this ayah, the meaning of which is Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam tells the king that, appoint me over the storehouses of the land. Indeed, I will be a knowing guardian. So remember, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam advised them that from the crops that you reap in the 7 years of good rain and a good agriculture, you need to store the grain in the spikes and make sure you store these grains in the storehouses. Why? When the 7 years of drought comes, you are able to feed the people. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam here says, make me in charge of those storehouses. We learn from this aspect, respected elders and brothers, my dear listeners, the permissibility of one putting forward one's qualification. If someone feels that he's qualified for a job, then it is permissible for him to actually go out and put out his credentials and say that, listen, I am qualified for this job. Now, obviously the teaching of Islam is that, and this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, that you shouldn't give positions to those who ask for it. It doesn't mean somebody says, you know what, I want to be in this committee, or I want to be in this company, or I want to take this job responsibility, that you end up giving it to them. That's not the teaching of Islam. You give job responsibilities to those who are qualified to take over that job responsibility. But obviously, without doubt, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is the most qualified. So you may get the job, you may not, but Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam puts his credentials forward. In this ayah here, we learn an important aspect, and that is إِنِّي حَفِيظٌ أَمِينٌ. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says, or mentions and teaches us, two qualities that should exist in a person before he applies for a job. He needs to be حَفِيظ and he needs to be أَمِين. Subhanallah. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam teaches us two qualities or criteria that is important. Criteria that should exist in a person of authority. And those who are actually advisors, they need to be hafiz, meaning trustworthy, those who look after, and وَإِنِّي حَفِيظٌ عَلِيمٌ. They need to be knowing and knowledgeable. This is important. You can't give somebody a job who's trustworthy, but he doesn't have no knowledge of the job. A person who you feel you can trust, this person can actually do, or he's trustworthy, I have no problem with him looking after my finances, my business, or I have no problem taking advice from him, he's a sincere person, but he doesn't have the knowledge. In that circumstance, he's not qualified for the job. Or a person who has the knowledge for the job, but he's not trustworthy. So he might know the pros and cons of something, he might be specialized in a particular field, however, he's not trustworthy. Him being there is actually detrimental to that post. In that circumstance, you can't hire him also. So this is a lesson for those who actually hire personnel. They need to be from amongst those who have two important qualities. One is hafiz and one is alim. They need to be knowledgeable and they need to be trustworthy. They need to be a guardian over the job responsibility that they will be taking over. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ مَكَّنَّا لِيُوسُفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ يَتَبَوَّأُ مِنْهَا حَيْثُ يَشَاءُ نُصِيبُ بِرَحْمَتِنَا مَنْ نَشَاءُ وَلَا نُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَى. Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam, from where to where? He started off as a young boy in a well, and now he is made the minister of Egypt. He has a high post, and on top of all that, he is in charge of the storages of all this food. Now remember, 7 years are going to come, the 7 difficult years. And Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam has the difficult responsibility of making sure that the crops are harvested and enough is stored and the storages are safe and there's no funny business going on. Everything is correct and up to date. We have 7 years in front of us. You need a person who truly is qualified. And as we said, there is nobody more qualified than Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and thus we established Yusuf in the land to settle therein wherever he wills. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, as a minister now, he was no more a slave. He could walk the land, he could go wherever he wanted to do. He was a man of status, he was a man of authority. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we touch with our mercy those whom we wish, and we do not allow to be lost the reward of those who do good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful, and His mercy is upon those who He wishes it to be on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not waste the rewards of those who do good. And this is something we need to understand. Respected listeners, also another sunnah and way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation. لا نضيع أجر المحسنين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never let the good of those who do good go to waste. As long as you are doing good, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give it to you in this world, then indeed He will give it to you in the hereafter. Don't ever lose hope. Don't ever feel, I am doing so much good, but my du'as are not being answered. Again, this is from the weakness of iman. Or maybe shaitan will play with you. You feel that you're doing so much good and the next person is doing bad, but I'm not enjoying as much as the next person. Know and understand, لا نضيعُ أجر المحسنين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not waste the reward of those who are, or those who do good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you in full. If He doesn't reward you in this world, He will in the next. And which is a better place to receive the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا أَجْرُ الْآخِرَةِ خَيْرٌ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the reward is better for a believer in the hereafter. And we know that the reward of the hereafter is Jannah. Subhanallah, ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. A place that no mind has ever imagined, no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard. Subhanallah, no heart has ever desired. What better place to get the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Again, as we said, this ayah or the surah is meant to optimize you. It was revealed at a time when the Muslims were going through difficulties and sufferings. And I did say that we're trying to teach the surah to one and all, because we find the Muslim ummah today also going through a tough time. We are not optimistic. We're having trouble being optimized. So inshallah, the surah is a means of making one optimistic, making one have confidence and feel that indeed there is hope, and definitely there is hope. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we touch with our mercy those who we wish, and we don't let the good of those who do good go to waste. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا أَجْرُ الْآخِرَةِ خَيْرٌ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And alhamdulillah, we are all from the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the reward of the believers, خَيْرٌ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. For a believer is better. وَلَا أَجْرُ الْآخِرَةِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the reward of the hereafter is better for those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who were fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't ever lose hope, my dear mothers and sisters, my dear fathers and brothers. You carry on doing good. The rest is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't get it here, you'll get it in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the reward of the hereafter is better. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us both in this world and the hereafter. Ameen. Now, the story enters yet another phase. I still apologize. I know I'm going fast. I did excuse myself and say that we are stuck with time. We don't have much time on our side. The story enters another phase. After so many years, obviously, from the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاءَ إِخْوَةُ يُوسُفُ. we get the understanding that the 7 years of harvest is now gone. 7 whole years have passed and we have entered the phase of drought, the 7 years of drought, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the brothers of Yusuf came seeking food, seeking sustenance, and this is the beauty of the Quran. As we said, just in one ayah we can extract so many meanings and we can understand so much more. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاءَ إِخْوَةُ يُوسُفَ فَدَخَلُوا عَلَيْهِ فَعَرَفَهُمْ وَهُمْ لَهُ مُنْكِرُونَ, that the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam came seeking food and they entered upon Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam recognized them, he recognized all of them, but to them Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was unknown. Now remember, when Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was in the well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the day will come when you will tell them of their actions whilst they do not know you. Now, obviously this is not the day, meaning not the day that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam informs them of their actions, but the day has come whereby he recognizes them and they don't recognize him. And obviously a long time has passed. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was 7 years when he was in the well. Then he had to have spent another 7 years with the minister of Egypt because he reached the age of puberty. Then he was 7 years in the prison. Then 7 years of good harvest has passed. Already we are 28 years. So we're looking at Yusuf being around the age of 30. And that's a long time. And the second aspect is, who would have thought that we're coming from a foreign land into Egypt? Remember, the brothers are coming all the way from Palestine. We're coming into Egypt. Who would have, I mean, the last thing on their minds is Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He's long forgotten. Obviously, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam still remembers him, as we'll see later on. But the brothers have long forgotten about Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And who would have thought that that little boy, so many years ago, will end up being the minister of the land in charge of all the storages? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ مَكَّنَّا لِيُسْفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ, that this is how we establish Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam in the land. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. In any difficulty you are going through, my dear mother, my dear sister, my dear parents, my dear fathers and mothers, know and understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. There is nothing impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do. Put your hands up and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for assistance. Don't ask others before you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. So they enter upon Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They don't recognize him, he recognizes him. Okay? And we did say that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam must be close to 30 now. And also the last thing on their minds is actually seeing Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, after all this time, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam must have had a serious feeling of getting, you know, one up on them. Obviously, so long has gone, subhanAllah, all of a sudden they are walking here. This is the time I should inform them of what they've done. I should tell them that, what did you guys do to me? You left me in the well. How is my father? What did he make of the whole affair? Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, again, he doesn't let the heat of the moment get the better of him. He doesn't fall prey to al-istidraq fi lahzatin hadira. He is composed, he is in control. And he deals with them properly. He has a plan in mind and he's going to let that plan go through appropriately. وَلَمَّا جَهَزَهُمْ بِجَهَازِهِمْ, so he sees them, they've come for food, obviously, they have paid their merchandise. وَلَمَّا جَهَزَهُمْ بِجَهَازِهِمْ قَالَ أَتُونِي بِأَخِلْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَبِيكُمْ. Now obviously, it was the policy that each person that comes would get a camel's load of food. So obviously they've come, 10 brothers, and they say we are 11. But the other brother is at home, so can we have 11 camels of food? So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, he obviously knew there were 11 brothers because he remembers Binyamin, who was his blood brother. Remember Binyamin at the beginning. We said Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and Binyamin were blood brothers. They were the sons of one mother. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says, listen, where is this other brother? I cannot give you food unless you bring forward this other brother. And obviously we get the impression that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam actually sat with these people. He was being, you know, hospitable to them, speaking to them, finding out about their situation. Where have you come from? They look foreign. Obviously he knew they were foreign, but he dealt with them appropriately. And we'll see it in the next ayah where Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam speaks to them. He shows how generous he was to them. A proper ruler, a proper leader, and we always spoke about the superior character of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and indeed he had superior character and quality in his ability to deal with people. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says that, listen, where is this last brother? You have to bring him to me before I can actually give you his load. Then Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says, أَلَا تَرَوْنَ أَنِّي أُوفِ الْكَيْنِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُ الْمُنزِلِينَ. This is proof of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's hospitality to them. He's speaking to them properly that, look, don't you see me as generous? A person who is whose quality is to be generous. I've accepted you here. I've sat down with you. He's being hospitable to them. That's why he's saying, do you not see I am generous? Obviously, for them to see that he was generous, he had to be giving to them. He probably received them properly. And as we said from the Quran, in a few ayahs, we can understand so much. This is from the ijaz of the Quran, the ability of the Quran to describe so much appropriately in so little words. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect, and we say, La ilaha illallah. So the fact that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is saying, Ala tarawna anni ufi al-kayl, do you not see that I give full measure? Do you not see that I am the best of accommodators? Wa ana khayrul munzilin. So that teaches us that he was accommodating to these people, he was being hospitable to them. So he said, listen, I'm willing to help you on condition that you bring me this person. I can't just give you a whole camel's load of food because you say you have a brother. I need to see him in front of me. And then what does he say after that? And this is also a lesson for us. He says, فَإِن لَمْ تَأْتُونِي بِهِ فَلَا كَيْلَ لَكُمْ عِنْدِي وَلَا تَقْرَبُونَ. He says, but if you do not bring him to me, then there will be no measure for you. You will not receive the amount of food that you are after. There will be no measure for you, nor will you approach me. Don't even come near to me. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا. Don't even approach me, because unless you bring him, I'm not willing to listen. We learn the characteristics of a person who is a leader, and the characteristics that should exist in those who are leaders, in the teachers, in our fathers. These qualities must exist, whereby you are accommodating, you facilitate, you compromise, you assist, but in the same breath, you are straightforward and stern, and you don't beat around the bush. You say, listen, I am hospitable to you, I am accommodating you, do you not see that? So bring your brother to me, I will give you the load of or the measure that you are looking for. However, if you don't bring him to me, then don't waste my time, don't come back to me. So this is the qualities that should exist in a leader. He is compromising and he facilitates, but at the same time, he's straightforward, he's apt, and he's responsible. He doesn't say one thing and do another thing. And this is a problem which we find, especially amongst the Muslims today, whereby we just say things to make people happy or to buy us more time, and then what do? We end up doing totally something else. And I did mention that this is from bad character, especially in our businesses, especially in our dealings with other people. This is from the bad characteristics not praised by Islam. Islam doesn't praise these qualities whereby you just say things to make people happy, you don't be principled, and you say something and you do something else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is good with them, he tells them, he's willing to listen to them, but he says, listen, if you don't follow the condition that I'm setting here, that you bring this brother of yours, then I am not interested. So what did the brother say? قَالُوا سَنُرَاوِدُ عَنْهُ أَبَاهُ وَإِنَّا لَفَعِلُونَ. Subhanallah. As if they are being arrogant. It's a type of arrogance. Their father is Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. But what do they say? They said, we will attempt to persuade his father. They didn't say our father, even though Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam is their father. They said, we will attempt, and look at the way they're saying, سَنُرَاوِدُ. We will attempt to, we will try to. I mean, you know, we've done it before, we'll do it again. A type of arrogance. سَنُرَاوِدُ عَنْهُ أَبَاهُ, his father, وَإِنَّا لَفَعِلُونَ. And we will be able to do it. Subhanallah. A type of arrogance. We will attempt to persuade his father to let him go, and don't worry about it, we'll manage. Why? Because they did it before. So they show a type of arrogance. They use the word سَنُرَاوِدُ, subhanAllah. And then they refer to their father as Binyamin's father. And then they say, don't worry, without doubt, we will do it.
وَقَالَ لِفِتْيَانِهِ جَعَلُوا بِضَاعَتَهُمْ فِي رِحَالِهِمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَعْرِفُونَهَا إِذَا انْقَلَبُوا إِلَى أَهْلِهِمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ.
So So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, after that, he commands his servants, the people that are working for him, obviously. He is a person of status and honor. He has people working for him, packing the food, measuring the camel loads, etc., taking the payment and the like. So he tells these people that, listen, put the merchandise that you received from these people into their saddlebags, or into the bags that they came with, into the bags that you've put their food in, so that they might recognize it when they have gone back to their people, and that perhaps they will return. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says that, listen, just put these or put their merchandise back. Now, the ulama of tafsir mentioned reasons why Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam requested his servants to put these or the merchandise, or that which they, remember, they used to trade, they used to give something for something, so they were giving some merchandise of this for the food. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam says, put the merchandise back with the food, put it in such a way that they don't know. Don't put it in a way that maybe if they're halfway they'll see it and come back. This is the plan of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And the ulama of tafsir mentioned that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam did this, why? Because he feared poverty for them, and he thought that if they went all the way back and they didn't have money, they wouldn't even come back. So that's one aspect. And the second aspect, as we'll see later, that the merchandise that he did put back was a means of convincing their father to release Binyamin. Because obviously they went back and they said, listen, we have to take Binyamin with us or we will not get the load. And Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam categorically refused. He refused. Why? Because he remembered what happened with Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Then they found this merchandise in the main luggage that they had, and that was used as a way of persuading Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. But that will come up just now. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam commands the servants to do this, and the story continues. فَلَمَّا رَجَعُوا إِلَىٰ أَبِيهِمْ قَالُوا يَا أَبَانَا مُنِعَ مِنَّا الْكَيْلِ فَأَرْسِلْ مَعَنَا أَخَانَا نَكْتَلْ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Now, and we do know that these boys are professionals when it comes to being dramatic. Remember, when they went back to Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam after getting rid of Yusuf, what did they do? They cried crocodile tears. They prepared the scene properly. They cried crocodile tears and they went and they used emotional blackmail on their father, trying to convince him that something actually happened to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. The same thing they do over here. They show the ability to actually dramatize situation. They said, or when they returned to their father, مُنِعَ مِنَّ الْكَيْلِ. And those of us who understand the Arabic language will understand the context of their statement properly. We'll try and interpret it in the English language as best as we can. However, they went to their father and they said, oh, our father, measure has been denied to us. They refuse to give us food. They are being dramatic. They're not saying that we sat down and he considered us and he assisted us and he was hospitable to us and he told us very nicely that, listen, just bring this brother of yours and once you bring him, I'll give you a camel's share, or meaning I'll give you a measurement for this brother of yours. They didn't say it like that. They dramatized the whole event and they said, measure has been denied to us. So make sure or send us with our brother, so that we'll be given this measure, and indeed we will be the guardians. So إِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظٌ. And this is what they told their father when they wanted to take Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam out at the beginning of the story. For those who remember, they said, إِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظٌ. The exact same thing they told their father, that, listen, we are guardians over Binyamin. He's our brother. You have nothing to worry about. Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam responds and says, قَالَ هَلْ آمَنُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ إلا كما أمنتكم على أخيه من قبل فالله خير الحافظ وهو أرحم الراحمين. سبحان الله. يعقوب عليه الصلاة والسلام says, I mean, and rightfully he's saying, should I trust you with him, with Binyamin, like how I trusted you with Yusuf عليه الصلاة والسلام. سبحان الله. I mean, after all, you said that you were going to be guardian over Yusuf عليه الصلاة والسلام and protected over him. Should I trust you with him again? And we need to understand something here, respected elders and listeners, that in this circumstance, the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam are truthful. This time, they are not plotting and planning. They are actually truthful. They want to take Binyamin so they can get this measure. They have no interest in harming him. They have no plan or plot in getting rid of him. So this teaches us a valuable lesson, that having a bad reputation doesn't work in our favor. Now, they are truthful. But the reputation of the past is being used against them. That listen, you told me you were going to look after Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and you guys did what you did with him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this. Do you expect me to trust you with Binyamin, his brother now? So we learn here the importance of considering one's reputation before entering a transaction. Whether it's business, whether it's normal dealings, whether you're going to hire somebody, a guardian over your children, you know, the schools that you're going to put your children in, you've got to look at the reputation of the institution. Whether it's a boy who's proposing for a girl, or a girl who's proposing for a boy, you've got to look at the reputations of these people. This is what we learn here. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is acting upon what? Upon the previous actions of these boys. Upon the reputation that they had. So, this teaches us the importance of one actually looking at the past. Obviously, not that we dig out somebody's low points and then go out and spreading it to community, to the rest of the community and gossiping about them. No. Obviously, you dig out or you look at the reputation of the person for your own benefit, to assist you, to help you make a decision, not so that you can go and spoil people's names. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is acting upon their previous activities and says, listen, you told me the last time you were going to support Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, you were going to look after him. Do you expect me to trust you with Binyamin the same way I trusted you with Yusuf? And then Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam says, فَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ حَافِظًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best guardian. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ, and he is the most merciful. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the merciful, or the most merciful of all those who have mercy. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is saying, in that case, if it entails that I send Binyamin with you, I'm not going to do that. I will not do that. فَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ حَافِظًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a protector over us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look after us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the most merciful of all those who are merciful. He will never let us starve. He will never let us go hungry. If, you know, me getting this last measurement of food entails me letting my son go with you, then no, let's just forget about the whole thing. I am not sending Yusuf Binyamin with you. I am categorically saying no. End of story, I'm not interested. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of protectors, and He is the most merciful. He will look after us. He will never let us go astray. So now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never let us go astray, and He'll never ever let us go hungry. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ. So now, end of story. Their ploy and plot failed. The dramatizing that they did not work. Why? Because of their previous reputation. وَلَمَّا فَتَحُ مَتَاعَهُمْ. So now, Yusuf's plan comes into play. Remember, he put the merchandise back in their bag. وَلَمَّا فَتَحُوا مَتَاعَهُمْ وَجَدُوا بِضَاعَتَهُمْ رُدَّتْ إِلَيْهِمْ. When they opened their luggage, obviously, opening up the measurements that they received from Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, what happened? They found their merchandise with them. They found the merchandise returned to them. قَالُوا يَا أَبَانَ مَا نَبْغِي, هذه بضاعتنا ردت إلينا ونمير أهلنا ونحفظ أخانا ونزداد كيل بعير ذلك كيل يسير. سبحان الله. They went back to their father and said, oh our father, oh dear father of ours, what more could we desire? ما نبغي, we don't want to cause any harm to Binyamin. This is not our intention. ما نبغي, we don't want this. هذه بضاعتنا ردت إلينا, look, the king is so merciful, he has returned our merchandise to us. So what we're telling you is a true story, that we met this merciful king. We met this king who's so hospitable. And he told us to come with Binyamin. He told us to bring this brother of ours so we can get the measurement. Subhanallah. So now Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's plan is coming into effect. They are using the merchandise that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam returned to them to convince their father. They're saying, Manabri, we don't want anything. We don't mean any evil. We don't want any harm. All we want is to get this measurement of food. We are going through a drought. It's difficult to get food. It is important. And we should remember, these brothers were big. They were married. They had families. So a lot of mouths to feed. So Manabri, هذه بضاعتنا ردت إلينا, our merchandise has been returned to us. ونمير أهلنا ونحفظ أخانا ونزداد كيل بعير, our merchandise has been returned to us, and we will obtain food for our family and protect our brother and obtain an increase of a camel's load. Then they say, ذلك كيل يسير, and indeed this is an easy measurement. just a matter of taking Binyamin, putting him in front of the minister of Egypt, who now was Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and very easily receiving an extra camel's load of measurement. Subhanallah. So now Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is thinking, قَالَ لَنْ أُرْسِلَهُ مَعَكُمْ حَتَّى تُؤْتُونِي مَوْثِقًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ لَتَأْتُنَّنِي بِهِ إِلَّا أَيُّحَاطَ بِكُمْ. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, looking at the substantial evidence in front of him, that you know what, these sons might be telling the truth. I mean, look, the king has to be merciful and has to be hospitable. He's actually returned our merchandise back. And this teaches us, you know, the aspect of considering somebody. Don't just close your mind on somebody. People make mistakes. Consider them. Take a moment and consider that which they are saying or that which they have come with. And obviously, looking at their reputation, but not in a circumstance where you're not even willing to give them a chance. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam giving his sons a chance teaches us that we should also give others a chance. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam looks at the evidence and he says, listen, okay, I'll send Binyamin with you. However, on a condition. The first time, he didn't place a condition. This time, he places a condition. He says, I will not send him with you except that you give me a promise and an oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will bring him back to me. So, I will send him with you, however, on a condition. On condition that you swear by Allah, subhanallah. He says, you swear by Allah that you're going to bring him back to me. If you do this, then I will send Binyamin with you. So he says, حَتَّى تُؤْتُونِي مَوْثِقًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ لَتَأْتُنَّنِي بِهِ إِلَّا أَيُّ حَاطَ بِكُمْ فَلَمَّا آتَوْهُ مَوْثِقَهُمْ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَا نَقُولُ وَكِيلٌ. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam says, listen, I'm sending him with you on condition that you give me an oath that you're going to bring this boy back to me. You will bring Binyamin back to me. Except, of course, in a circumstance that is impossible, is not within your reach and means, maybe you are surrounded by an enemy and something then happens. In that circumstance, I am willing to listen to your excuse and I will forgive you. However, in any other circumstance, make sure, I want you to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you bring him to me. Subhanallah. This is Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam talking to his sons, considering them despite the past reputation, advising them once more, the love of a father to his child. In fact, we will see more love of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam upon his sons when he asks his sons to enter through the different doors when they're getting into Egypt. So, he tells them that, listen, swear by Allah that you're going to bring him to me. The only excuse I'll have if you end up coming and you and Binyamin gets lost is, you know, maybe we were surrounded by an enemy and something happened to him. Obviously, that's not within your means. So I want you to take qasam by Allah that you will do everything within your means to make sure that Binyamin actually returns to me. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا آتَوْهُ مَوْثِقَهُمْ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَا نَقُولُ وَكِيلٌ. That Allah that after they had given their promise and after they swore by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam said, or he used Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a witness and said, Allah over what we are saying or this transaction in agreement of ours is a witness. Now, our time has almost come to an end, so we'll stop here. Once again, I apologize for the speed that we are going at. There's so much to say. I've left out so much already, and there's still so much to say. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us. Just before the program ends today, I just want to go through the benefits that we get from this last ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereby he's telling us what transpired between Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam and his children. I did mention a few fawaid that you obviously deal with people on their reputation. However, not in a manner where you go around the city and you spoil their name. That's the first thing. The second thing is, even though somebody might have a bit of a bad reputation, it doesn't mean there's all bad in them. It means they're still good and there are circumstances where you can consider dealing with them. Obviously here he tells them that, listen, I'm considering. What I'll do is I'll give him to you after you swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We learn from this also the aspect that when you take a qasam and an oath, you only swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and on nothing else. Today, unfortunately, we find elements in society, they swear by, you know, their mothers, I swear by my, you know, you hear them saying, and this is also from the children, they say, I take qasam by my mother and I take a qasam by my father. A'udhu billah. This is shirk. This is totally unacceptable and against the teachings of Islam. The hadith says, man halafa bighayri Allah faqad kafara aw ashrak. That the one who takes an oath besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has actually suffer disbelief or ashrak associated partners with Allah. Obviously, the ulama have taught us that this is minor shirk. And in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man kana halifan, falyahlif billah aw liyasmut." That whoever takes a qasam and an oath, then make sure that you swear only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, otherwise you keep quiet. So this teaches us, respected elders and brothers, my dear mothers and sisters, my dear fathers, make sure you don't swear on anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya'qub alayhi salatu wa salam told his children that I'll only send Binyamin with you if you take a qasam. A qasam by who? By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You take a pledge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you swear by Allah. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said a qasam by Allah, he didn't just leave it as a qasam, is a lesson for us that we only swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I said before, every word in the Quran is a lesson for us. Our time has unfortunately come to an end. I thoroughly enjoyed myself with you this morning. I ask your forgiveness if I have said anything wrong. Everything correct in this tafsir is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He is perfect. If I did make any mistake, it's from myself and shaytan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala His forgiveness. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.